and then this will be 4, 4 plus 3, 7, and this will be 2, 7 plus 2, 9, plus 4 more here. 9 plus 4, 13. If you think I'm just talking to myself as a madman, then you have not understood anything about these networks. You should be able to understand my monologue here, in, you know, looking at this network and telling you how many probabilities. So this required 13 separately assessed numbers. And that one only required 10 separately assessed numbers. But it turns out both of them, you know, if you actually, if the experts know what they're talking about, both of them correspond to the same final joint distribution. Now that would mean, of course, that if only you knew the causal order, you would have asked the expert to, you would have asked the expert the variables in the causal order. But remember, there's an expert who knows something about causality, and there's a knowledge engineer who knows something about Bayes network too. Between them, they can very well start in the wrong order. Okay? And then, of course, this is not even the worst. What is the worst for this scenario? It will have to be essentially 31 probabilities. And that network corresponds to that. So you put in, first of all, Mary calls, then John calls, then earthquake, then burglary, then alarm. Then in that case, you can convince yourself that in most of the dependencies hold, and then you have to wind up getting all the errors. This is actually part of the project you're going to do. You will take one network, which is obvious, like this one, and you will write it in a different way. In that particular case, you happen to have the ground truth, so you can compute the numbers. You don't have to go back to the expert. But here, if you were doing only this, you would ask expert for these numbers. If you're only doing that, you would ask expert for those numbers. And furthermore, notice that if you put the variables in the causal order, you would be asking the expert for causal direction probabilities. And we made this huge deal about the fact that causal probabilities are the ones that are the textbooks. Plus. So the expert will give you the numbers you ask, but they're much happier to give those numbers. Because they think about the world in the causal direction. Now, to blow your mind, understand if there is no expert, you don't know which is right. This is what our Bozo ancestors were doing. And this is what we are doing every day for domains that we don't yet completely understand. They didn't know whether, you know, sun was going around earth or earth was going around sun. The network is not causality, it's just correlation. Okay? Questions? Yes?
I'm slightly confused on the justification for putting those in for flurry to earthquake.
Yes, because by this time I already know alarm. And if I, basically the question you'll be asking is, given when I put earthquake in, then if I know the status of all these things, is burglary going to be dependent on earthquake? And that was the whole point we made, that the moment alarm goes off, you know, if you actually know that burglary occurred, then you don't need the earthquake to occur. Again, if you don't get confused, you're not understanding. Okay, this stuff is deep. Okay, because we, as I said in that name, humans don't understand probabilistic reasoning. You know, if we do bad logical reasoning, we make fun of the person who makes illogical reasoning. But we don't actually understand well, you know, from a common sense point of view, how probabilities work. And that's what, as I said in that thing, you know, advertisers basically, you know, take advantage of. So, they, and then this is why Monte Hall problem is so unintuitive. How can it be that it's the right solution is to change your decision, and yet none of you would think that that's the case? And also, I don't know if you clicked on that Simpson's paradox. That's again, like, all the undergrads are worried about their grades in this class. All the grad students, the majority of undergrads are worried about the grades in their class. Majority of grad students are also worried about grades in the class. But if you take the entire class, majority of people are happy with that, how they're doing. That can happen in real world. And you think intuitively, if subsets are in one trend, the superset should be in the same trend. But that's not required, as probabilities are ratios. Understand Simpson's paradox, because you're going to live through it in your life. Okay? So it is important to understand this, you know, the independence question. By the way, experts will just tell you, yeah, it's independent or it's dependent. But there are actually ways to check whether it is independent or not. You can set up an experiment in the world and construct probabilities, and basically assess the frequentist probabilities and see if in fact they're independent. Okay? But here we're just asking the experts. So if you introduce the variables in the causal order, then you are actually in better off. But then that's like, you know, if I only know this, then I know the causation in the world. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Especially in biology, you don't know what causes what. And so if you are trying to help your biology, you know, expert come together, put together like a base network for their domain, they have no clue what the causality is there. Okay? Again, this, I said this like a million times, I want to say it again. Arrow direction is not causality. Remember this. Sometimes arrow direction can be causality. But generally, arrow direction doesn't have to be causality at all. Arrow direction only means probabilities are correlated. And remember that for the same domain, I can write any of these networks. And you can't very well have every network be causal direction. Okay? So R and arrow from A to B implies is that to specify the network, you need to provide conditional probability of B given A. Okay? And then a joint distribution of A and B, P, A, B, can either be written, if I know this, I can either write it as a network where A causes A linked to B, or a network where B is linked to A. And given the joint distribution, I can say either of those networks will capture that joint distribution. It's very important to understand what the arrows mean and what they do. Okay? And then actually, for that matter, implication in logic also doesn't mean causation. A implies B is nothing but not A or B. It's not causation at all. We just kind of overload the semantics and say, implication must be causation. In fact, the theory of causation is actually a different branch altogether in general. In AI, actually, the guy who came up with this, and I forgot to show the picture, the guy who did the most amount of work on Bayes network is Julia Pearl, which is why we talk about the Pearl network. This is the network. And so Julia Pearl, actually, his current work is a lot of it is about theory of causation. And in general, theory of causation require this notion of interventions. If you think A is causing B, if you stop A from happening, then B should happen. Okay? Remember the joke that you know that the probability that there have been two bombs on the network is extremely low, so I'll take one bomb with me. That is a classic example of misunderstanding correlation and causation. You taking the bomb doesn't cause the other guy to not take the bomb. You can try that out. You taking the bomb only makes sure that you will spend, you know, a whole bunch of years in jail. Nothing else. And so causal theories actually require that if you intervene and then stop the cause, then the symptom shouldn't occur. That requires costly experimentation. Okay. Now, one more thing that we're going to do is, so we already do this network, so I'm still continuing the same manual network specification mode. Okay. And there are things that we can do to further reduce the number of numbers that you need experts to do. Okay. So in many cases, conditional probability tables Basically, the joint distribution is too big, so you came up with this factorization idea so that, you know, the Bayes network can tell you what numbers to ask. But then now, given a Bayes network, the hardest thing would be the node in the Bayes network with the maximum number of parents. That would basically get meter, the maximum number of probabilities. If you have a node in a Bayes network with m parents, you'd wind up needing 2 power m probabilities, conditional probabilities, just to specify the CPT for that node. Okay, so it's the order of the dominating factor is the node with the maximum number of parents. So one important thing is that you would like to reduce the number of nodes with too many parents. Do you understand what I just said? So you might want to do it by introducing fake nodes into the network that don't have any direct observable semantics in the domain. But all they do is they mediate the influence between some nodes and some other nodes. To explain that, let me tell you this. Imagine, essentially, okay, so imagine this, you know, think of this as all of these are a whole bunch of nodes, okay? And then basically all of them are impacting the value of all these nodes. So a simple way of thinking about it is think of those top ones as your homework 1 score, homework 2 score, homework 3 score, homework 4 score, exam 1 score, exam 2 score, whatever else, all the scores. And this bottom one is individual grades. Your grade depends on all of them. Right? So upfront, I'll have to put links from everybody to everyone. Everybody in the top, everybody. So imagine that there are m parent nodes, and these are m children nodes. Then this guy requires 2 power m numbers. That means to specify this network, I need m times 2 power m numbers. But suppose I realize, hey, you know, the way the grades are actually determined is not on individual scores, but some function of these scores. Let's say average, like the cumulative value of your exam, you know, weighted average or something, of your exam and homework, etc. You see what I'm saying? Then this is an intermediate node, I'll just put it in here. This blue node. These are observable. These are actual scores. This can be observed. This intermediate node cannot be observed at all. But I put it in, and then I will basically say, well, to the extent I am assuming that that semantics is it's a cumulative score, then the cumulative score depends on every one of the parents, and then it impacts every one of the children. You see this? All I did is I sparsified the network. This is another technical term that you can impress. I sparsified the network. This was a dense network. Every node had n parents. And I just threw in this intermediate node, you know. And I just basically hope for the best. In this particular case, I actually have some semantics in this case. So I said, well, this will be affected by these, and this will affect each other. It looks like, you know, what did I do here? Well, you did a huge improvement in the number of numbers that you would have to actually get. Okay? Because right now, this guy will require 2 power n numbers just here. But then each of these guys will just require 2 numbers. I'm assuming Boolean, because it's no longer Boolean, but if you're assuming it's Boolean, okay, all these variables are Boolean, you only require 2 numbers. So instead of m times 2 power n, okay, then I'm just getting just 1 2 power n plus 2 times n. Humongous reduction in the number of numbers I need. Do people understand this? So you invent intermediate concepts. You invent intermediate concepts just to make the knowledge graph more compact, the base network more compact in terms of the network. In terms of the number of numbers you have access. Looks strange, but it's actually very important thing to do, just a second. So here is a network. This is stuff that you can use today. You know, at the end of the class, you can go off and start in like an auto mechanic thingy. You know, and this I tell you, you know, by authority that this is apparently very good. You can use this to kind of diagnose what's wrong with the car. Okay, so these are all the observable things. You know, car won't start, gas gauge, eye light, lights, etc. And these are all other things that you can also actually observe. Battery is dead, no oil, no gas, fuel line is blocked, starter broken, etc. Some of them take more time to observe because that's what you pay the auto mechanic for. But they are observable. But then there are also these things like no charging, okay, or battery flat, which are intermediate nodes. And they just basically, you throw them in so that you can basically make the connections between the top level nodes and the bottom level nodes most fast. Now, learning such, these are called hidden nodes or hidden variables, because the domain probably has semantics for these. You can actually test, there may be ways of checking. So for example, disease, at least by autopsy, you can tell whether somebody had the disease. Not the best way, but that's the way you can tell whether they had the disease. Okay, symptom, you can just tell by looking at them, whether they have the symptom. There are these syndromes, which are in between. Many things you heard, like things like Down syndrome, things like AIDS, these are all syndromes. Syndromes don't need to cause. So a disease causes a syndrome may or may not cause the symptom. This is how medical knowledge is actually put together. And it turns out, one way of understanding it is it's a computational efficiency reason. Okay? This is another big car insurance, this is insurance network. By the way, networks can be of these sizes in general. Okay? And then it will be fun for you to actually look at, you know, how many numbers are needed. Okay? One thing that I should mention here, and again this is a foreshadowing thing, and this will actually happen next class, is if you are learning networks from just examples, there is no expert. Then the question is, how many intermediate nodes are you supposed to put? How many hidden nodes are you supposed to put? The whole point of hidden nodes are they are hidden. So throw in more and more hidden nodes, right? The problem then is when you see the data, the training data never gives you the values for the hidden nodes. In the best of cases also, it will never give you the values for the hidden nodes. So if, you know, without giving too much, without, you know, probably not to surprise you, you probably won't be surprised if I were to tell you that, you know, something like a burglary, earthquake, alarm, John calling, Mary calling, right? In this particular case, all of those things are observable. So the way normally I would learn, you know, let's say if I give you this topology and I'm supposed to find the, you know, the CPTs, the way I would do is I will go and look for examples, training examples. The training example is basically, oh, there is an event one when there was a burglary and there was no earthquake and there was no alarm and John did call, Mary didn't call. And another day, two, there was a burglary as well as an earthquake, and there was an alarm, and John called, and Mary called, and so on and so forth. These are the training examples. Given these training examples, you can compute the probabilities. What you would have done is probably just take ratios. And it turns out that the theory tells you you can take the ratios. That's what we'll do next class. But if I put in made-up hidden variables into this mix, I would never know what the values of the hidden variables are. yet I need to learn the CPTs at that real variable too. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay, that becomes a much harder learning problem. That is learning the Bayes network parameters given incomplete data, where incomplete means you don't know the values of some of the nodes in the network. And that is where, if we leave the course for next week, we'll talk about EM, expectation maximization algorithm. But even as I'm saying this, you should be thinking, this is not new. In the neural networks, what did you do? You know inputs, that everybody knows. You know outputs, you know what you're supposed to do at the output, what you're supposed to do for the output. How many layers are you supposed to put in the middle? And what the heck are those layers in the middle? It's anybody's guess. Only in the neural networks, we don't care about semantics. And all backpropagation is doing is, well, it turns out that like you can pass backpropagate the error at the highest, no, at the output layer to the intermediate layers. And in the neural networks, the intermediate layers don't have any semantics to begin with. If they had semantics, we won't be in this worry of explainable AI, how do we interpret neural networks? Because the middle layers are middle layers. They have no semantics. In Bayes networks, on the other hand, actually the middle layers will have semantics. In the sense, you will know the conditional probability tables, and so you can actually talk in terms of, you can talk in terms of what their semantics are in terms of this probability model. Giving an example, of course, these are some examples, no charging and battery. There is a one very big place where, you know, this sort of a thing becomes very important, is topic models. How many of you have heard of topic models? Okay, so I give you a whole bunch of text documents. Okay, and then you are essentially trying to say that these documents probably were generated by somebody who's trying to, you know, who had a set of topics from which they're trying to generate documents, and they pick some mix of topics, they generate a model, you know, a particular document and put it in the web. And then pick another mix, generate a document and put it in the web. What you will know is, you know what are the initial topics possible. You will know what are the documents that are put on the web. But these topic mixes, and actually to some extent also even the topics themselves, are hidden nodes. And what you're trying to do is reconstruct these hidden nodes. Reconstruct these hidden nodes by just looking at the observable nodes. And those of you who may have heard of LDA, latent Dirichlet allocation, that essentially the topic models, are, the topics are the, you know, material nodes, and you wind up learning them using AI. But the bigger point is you put these hidden nodes, not because you're masochistic, but because they reduce the amount of links in the network. Got it? That's one thing. The other way you can reduce the number of numbers to give to the network is these CPTs are too big. If there is like a, let's say a node N, a node which had N parents, then I know that I will wind up having to give 2 power N numbers in the most general case. What if I want to, for example, say that this, in this particular network actually, this node is really nothing but some arithmetic function of its parents. It's just a sum node, S-U-M sum. There is no conditional probabilities. It's a deterministic relation between the values of the parents and values of the child. Okay? If you happen to know those deterministic relations hold, essentially you don't need to go for 2 power n numbers. It's just, you just give the relation. If it is something close to being deterministic, you may sometimes be able to avoid having to give 2 power n numbers. As an example, since it's pre-Thanksgiving, we should think of good thoughts. Imagine you were subjected to a firing wave. Okay, there are N people trying to fire you. Right? Okay, this is a useful thing, you know, it happens every day. And and you are trying to essentially give the probability. So each of these n people are trying to fire it. It's a firing layer. Hey, firing layer, okay. And then the point, of course, is they don't talk to each other. They are all trying to kind of do the deal. But each of their guns might misbehave, misfire, or not work. So each of them have independent failures. So the question then is, what is the probability that I'll be alive given that all these people tried to fire at me? That's a reasonable thing to try to do. And I would say that you don't need two power n numbers. All you need to know is, what is the probability, independent probability, of every one of the gunners failing? So gunner one just got a gun, doesn't quite know how to fire, so probably higher probability of failure. Gunner two, you know, seasoned gunner, you know, very low probability of failure, and so on and so forth. If I give the independent failure probabilities of all of them, then one of the good things about this example is all that requires is one gunner to be successful. Then it's curtains for you, right? So the probability that you'll succeed is 1 minus the probability that basically, so all of them have to fail for you to live. Okay? So the probability you'll live is the multiplication of all their failures. The probability that you die is 1 minus that. Any subset of them work, you die. Now, if you don't like firing limbs, think of this also as there are multiple causes that can cause a fever. Fever being a symptom. Okay? And each of them fail to cause fever with some probability. So in essence, what you would like to do is, I will die if either this guy succeeds, or this guy succeeds, or this guy succeeds, or this guy succeeds. And they all fail with some probabilities. Or I will get fever if any of these causes actually succeed in causing fever. If all of them fail, then I won't get fever. This is actually close to being a logical relation. It is an R relation. It's just a noisy R. See what I'm saying? It's a noisy R. So, in fact, in a noisy R, you can essentially get by. So, for example, this is a little less worrisome thing. It's a cold, flu, and malaria. All of these causes can cause fever. Okay? And so, the fever basically in your network, fever has links from cold, flu, and malaria. So, you would think you would need 8 numbers. I will tell you, no, this is an actual noisy R distribution. It's a noisy R distribution. And so, in fact, I can get by with just 3 numbers. Okay? The numbers are, what's the probability that cold fails to cause fever? What's the probability that flu fails to cause fever? What's the probability that malaria fails to cause fever? Using that, then I can compute the probability that fever is caused. And fever is not caused, and from that I can compute the probability that fever is caused. Do you understand this? Now here is my question. If you have any of these variables to be continuous variables, we've been in this la la land, right? We've been thinking that fever is a Boolean variable, flu is a Boolean variable, cold is a Boolean variable, malaria is a Boolean. Okay, imagine I'm actually talking about, a relation between one continuous variable x and another continuous variable y. So x is a real valued number between, let's say, 0 and 1. And y is another real valued number between 0 and 1. And I need probability of y will be equal to yi given x equal to xi. Right? X equal to xj. Which is x taking some value, what's the probability that phi will take some other value? If it's just like single contingent, two continuous variables. How big would the table be if you try to give a table? How did you get by in your life doing probabilities when you had continuous variables? Have you ever touched continuous variables in probabilistic reasoning? How did you get by? What? Like what? Normal distribution. Poisson distribution. Student T distribution. When you were asked to do statistics courses, they gave you all these named distributions, which are a specific functional form connecting the probability of X to probability of Y. And a single function will essentially become a compact way of representing infinite numbers. If you're doing continuous variables, the only game in town is to write analytic named distributions. See what I'm saying? So coming from this side, we were used to having conditional probability tables, and we said, oh, we can also make them a little more compact by having things like noisier. If you came from the continuous side, that's the only game in town. In fact, people in the continuous distributions try to hope that the distribution that they are supposed to put in, oh, can I put in the normal distribution? Can I put in the student distribution? If it's neither of them, they say, what do I do now? Then you have to do non-parametric. What you've been doing all your life in discrete is non-parametric. So you've been there even before then. It's worthwhile to understand. Okay? That's about noisier. And one other thing in this context is to connect neural nets and belief nets. Everything has to be connected to everything so that either you use your whole mind and go start getting very mad, or they all stay together. So it turns out that you can think of neural networks as Bayes networks. In fact, there is a great course by Hinton and Coursera that's still available from 2012. Just at the dawn of neural networks finally actually working. And however, the reason basically, the thing that he was saying is, you know, they always had this problem of actually initializing networks. Always had the problem of initializing networks. Okay. So then he said, well, why don't we think of neural networks as Bayes networks? Okay? Of a particular kind. In fact, Bayes networks are way more complex. I mean, they're a lot more expressive in terms of semantics. If you can think of neural networks as Bayes networks, then the intermediate level nodes in neural networks become hidden variables in the Bayes network. So then you can use this thing that I didn't get described, but I said it exists, here, expectation maximization algorithm, to essentially compute the parameters. It'll be all fun and games. The question, of course, is if I have a network like this, okay? I have like n nodes here, you know, and then they're all connected to this single node here. If I view this as